הפעם חגיגה באולפן. האורח שלנו הוא הפסנתרן הנפלא, מארי פרהיה. שלום מאסטרו.
שלום, ארי.
I must tell you a story. About 2 weeks ago, I came back from Japan. It's a long flight, as you know. So I turned on the entertainment program, and I heard the Beethoven sonata. And it was the last movement. But it was so fantastic, so full with life. So I had to hear it, to listen to it all the way. And then they announced your name.
Sorry about that.
And you know what happened later? I had to listen to it once again. Oh. And once again, not I had to, I wanted. And the flight became so much shorter.
Oh, how nice. It's very nice, thank you.
This was Beethoven Sonata, Opus 14, number 2.
Yes.
Last movement and old sonata.
Right.
And this, as I must not tell you, is not a very deep, profound sonata, but it is so full with life.
Yes.
And my first question to you, how can you put so much life into your playing?
I wish, I don't know. In the last analysis, you work and I work a lot mentally and analyzing things. But in the last analysis, it's something inside that you don't know anything about that does the playing somehow. The spirit, the feelings, the inspiration, they come out instinctively. You don't know what brings them out.
You know, I find today many more pianists who can play with deep feeling and emotions, but very few could put life. What is this secret of life?
I don't know. I'm completely instinctive in terms of that. I do a lot of preparation. I think a lot about the piece. Also, I think a lot about the piece away from the piano. I'm not always tied to the piano in my work. But in the last moment, what happens at a performance is anybody's guess. And no one can predict the performance. You know, I was saying the other day, I was with a conductor and we were going to go on stage. And I was saying, you know, I have no idea how the performance is going to be. And this is the strangest profession in the world, where 2 minutes before it, you have no idea what you're going to produce.
Yeah. It's amazing how each great pianist has his voice.
Yeah, it is amazing. I mean, at the same instrument, two pianists sound totally different, and there's no real explanation for it. I find even more amazing, and I used to be in a conducting class where I would see this very often, four people get in front of an orchestra, not one sounds the same as the other, and it's the same musicians, and it's the same orchestra. It must be something in the gestures, I don't know.
Talking about conducting, we would like to see you as a conductor.
Oh, okay.
Okay. You like that?
You know, I can't judge myself. I think of the piece now, I'd have a little bit different tempo, it may be a little bit slower, I would play this more expressively or that. I can't watch myself, it's too difficult.
But the cue as a conductor, was fantastic, precisely, and they played together.
They played together. Well, they can do it without me, actually, they don't need me. I'm not really a conductor. I did study it, I do work with orchestras, but my love is the piano. And it will always be. And in fact, when there were periods when I couldn't play and my wife said I should conduct, I just couldn't do it because I felt I'm not a complete whole if I'm not a pianist. So,
but when you conduct from the piano stool, you feel at home. It's so wonderful to be the soloist conductor.
I love it because, first of all, you're really just playing chamber music, and that's my old love from when I was very young. I did a lot of chamber music, both in camps and privately. And I love the idea that the musicians are responsible for their music and that they join in with you. They have ideas, we try to accommodate, they accommodate to me. It's a real chamber music atmosphere.
Well, we haven't got an orchestra here for you, but we prepared the best piano we could. Would you play something for us?
Let's see, I don't know if I... this is from a Bach partita. It's Allemande from the first Bach partita.
I read recently a fantastic critique about Marie Perahia playing in New York, every Fischer or...
Yes, I just recently played the
thing. And they spoke about your stylistic approach.
I'm not consciously aware of stylistic problems, although when one hears Bach nowadays, you hear groups that are very aware of the way people played at the time, what they call authentic instruments. Sometimes it's very good and sometimes it's a little academic. But we grow up, I think, much more knowledgeable of certain practices in those days than other generations were. But in essence, I think that the things that matter and the things that are important in the music go beyond stylistic problems. They go to the heart. They go to what is the piece about emotionally. For instance, this piece and the other movements in this suite, they were about a present Bach gave to a little prince that was born. He also wrote a very beautiful poem. And you feel throughout this music a new life beginning to be born, and the excitement and the beauty of it. There's a movement that... feel that Bach is almost asking God to watch over this new life, be a protective force in this new life. In the end, it's the emotions and the harmonies that tell the emotions and the line that actually dictate the piece, much more than stylistic concerns. They did this in their time, they played short, they played a little kind of rubato, I don't know, note en egal. All of these things are to some extent important, but the most important thing is the heart still.
This menuetto in B flat major is so full with sunshine.
Exactly.
And when the authentic players do it, you feel it's just like a set of articulations.
It could be, yes, it could be an academic exercise, and they're so conscious of it. Mind you, they've given us a lot, too, in transparency. You remember when we were growing up, the textures in Bach were very heavy, and everybody played like a metronome a little bit. I mean, not that Bach was played very much. Glenn Gould played it, but aside from him, I remember pianists, great pianists, people like Arau, Clifford Curzon, telling me, you can't play Bach on the piano, it's not done. There are too many dynamics, you don't know, the instrument was not in Bach's sphere. But, I don't know, I was challenged by that more than I was deterred. I thought, why can't you play Bach on the piano? Why not? It's an instrument, the music lives, the piano lives, why not?
You know, in my youth, if a pedagogue, a teacher, wanted to improve the legato of a young pianist, you would give him Bach.
Yes.
Today, Bach is just set of staccato.
Yes.
But when you play Bach, there is the staccato in the minuet, and then the legato in the allemande.
I feel that the basic touch for Bach is, strangely enough, legato, because on the harpsichord, if you do... It sounds pretty awful. It's every note is the same. And you need some kind of touch that has nuance in it. Otherwise, you get the same sound for every note. And I'm sure that wasn't intended. You know, on the harpsichord, they're so careful about legato and super legato, where they actually hold notes over, so that this would be very foreign to them. In special pieces, they'd use that. But generally, the harpsichord would encourage legato with articulation, so that therefore it's not steady legato.
You play a lot of Bach.
I do. I play a lot of Bach. Yes, I love it.
Isn't it difficult in a large hall like every Fischer?
Yes, it is. It is very difficult. I don't know. You know, you are... people say you have to project into the large hall and you have to worry about the 2,000 people. That's not my approach. I approach it as deeply as I can, and I play for the way I can. I don't think in terms of approaching it, playing it for a public. And I think that they get it, because I'm more intense in what I'm doing than I am just in communicating, although I am aware of communicating. Music is communication.
And maybe this is your hidden secret. The first time I heard you was in every Fischer Hall.
Really?
You were a young boy.
Yes.
And you played the Weber concerto.
Ah, yes, the concerto.
Yeah,
yes.
Concerto.
No, that's Mendelssohn. I forgot.
But it's similar.
It's the same.
F major.
Yes.
Yeah. And I say to myself, well, this young man, he hasn't got a big sound, but yet his clarity and what he says is so marvelous, so that I have to listen to him, I have to try so hard, and therefore I can hear every note.
Well, that's what I try to do. No, and I find that also a big sound doesn't suit all the music. Not that I have it in abundance, but a big sound is fine for Brahms, but for Mozart and Chopin, you need sounds with nuance. Nuance is the thing that's the most important thing, I think, that we have, because getting louder, getting softer, expresses our emotions. Simply on a technical term, when you have a dissonant, let's say, I don't know, it has to be louder than a consonant so that you hear the anguish of that dissonance resolving and so on. And when we're playing Bach or playing Mozart, all these little dissonances fleet through, and each one has a voice of its own, a nuance of its own. So if one just thinks of a larger sound, one sort of smooths the whole thing down.
To convey this intimate feeling of Bach, this music of Bach, this partita, was not meant for 2,000. It's not a food you can feed 2,000 people in the restaurant. And yet you just tell them, come to me?
It's very nourishing. It is very nourishing, because it has so much in it. So much in many ways, intellectually too. And of course, emotionally, the sensitivity is very great. But I think Bach is the musician's bread.
The composers you play are Bach, Handel, Mozart, a lot of Mozart,
yes.
Schubert, Beethoven.
Yes, also Scarlatti.
Of course.
Scarlatti and Handel,
of course.
I did a lot. Beethoven, Mozart, and then later on, Schumann, Mendelssohn, Brahms. I seem to be forgetting some, but I don't know.
Not much French, not much Russian.
No, those were later. You know, when I worked a bit with Horowitz, he told me something which I've quoted quite a lot, and it was, you want to be more than a virtuoso, first be a virtuoso.
So that's beautiful. That's beautiful.
So we worked on music I had never done before, because my teacher just basically worked on the classics. We worked on Liszt, Rachmaninoff, Franck, the virtuoso Chopin. Not only for mechanical reasons, of course they're difficult, but they also get a sound out of the piano that you don't get just from the classical composers. So I did work on a bit of Debussy for a time. But since it was a natural part of my musical makeup, it's not something I kept to. I did also a lot of work with Bartok. But the things I've kept to are pretty much the things I studied with my first teacher, Bach, Mozart, Beethoven. I feel they give me so much nourishment. I'm still unraveling the mysteries of even a Bach invention is so difficult.
You mentioned Horowitz.
Yes.
You met all the great musicians of our time.
I was very privileged.
Can you tell us a little bit? Fischer-Dieskau.
Fischer-Dieskau I was just with 4 days ago in Berlin. It was a wonderful experience to be with him. I've worked with him, and he's a great, estimable artist.
You did the Winterreise.
I did the Winterreise with him, that's right. I was with Casals quite a lot because Casals liked me and he invited me to Puerto Rico. So I spent some holidays, well, weeks, in fact, with him in Puerto Rico. And when I look on it, I think, what a silly boy I was. He would get up every morning, 7 o'clock. I'm not an early riser, as you might have noticed. And 7 o'clock in the morning, and I was right under where he played, was very early in the morning. And every morning he would play 2 Bach preludes and fugues on the piano. And all I kept thinking of is I want to go back to sleep. And now I think, what a stupid person I was not to go up, watch him play, listen to it really. And all I remember was that he had a sort of beautiful sound and he never played the hands together like the old pianists,
yeah, yeah.
You know.
Tell us the secret of beautiful sounds.
I wish I knew it. I don't know, you know, pianists go into even books about sound production. And I try to read these books and they're Greek to me. I don't know about the level of the arm or the, I don't know, you probably know I've studied all of this. For me, it's Greek. It's something in the heart and the way you hear the music that tells you how the sound is playing. The combination of the way you hear it and the way your heart tells you to hear it. And for me, there's no magic. It just comes straight through. I sometimes think about technique, but largely it's instinctive.
Would you like to play for us something with beautiful sound? Something that can demonstrate the art of maybe a slow...
A slow movement. Maybe the Mozart slow movement. Just part of it.
Murray, you played about a week ago this recital in New York, and I read this review. Normally I don't like reviews, but that one I liked very much. You know why? Because the critic was not anymore in the chair of a critique.
Yes, I know what you mean.
Yeah, he became a music lover.
Yes.
And he said about you, Mozart, that you just gave him anything that a music lover would like to hear.
Yeah.
Did you play this movement
of
Mozart?
Yes, I did. Yes, this was one of the movements.
Yes. No wonder. No wonder.
Well, you know, I also feel like a music lover. Music is one of the most, for me, I'm so grateful for this gift of, well, it's of God, really, that I think like a music lover, too. I like beautiful sound. I like long melodies. I like to be swept away. I like emotions. I think when one gets too far from these things, either becomes too intellectual or too technical or whatever it is, you miss the most important element of music, which we all share. Whether you know about music or whether you don't know about music, you can all share the love of music if you have some feeling for what it is.
There are pianists who are good for the public, for everybody, yeah. And there are pianists who are good for pianists, for musicians. Rubinstein was good for everybody.
Everybody, yes. That's what one aims for. It's a universal language.
But every book must be your own autobiography, isn't it?
Of course, everything relates to feelings that you've had. But every one of us is miniature next to Beethoven. So we have to realize where we're growing, or certainly Bach and all of the great composers, had a wealth of wisdom that takes us years to understand. Years to understand the Beethoven phrase. Anybody who can sit down and play any Beethoven phrase and say, well, that's how I feel it, that's the way it goes. Yeah, it might be how you feel it, but your feelings are not touched with Beethoven's wisdom, either of music or of knowledge or of life or whatever, of humanity. So you have to grow in it. You go every day to that phrase and you try to work on it and understand why is that note there and why isn't it another one.
Speaking of Beethoven phrase, we have prepared one for you.
Oh, yeah. Years ago in another life.
You know, it's a minuetto.
Yes.
And such an innocent minuetto, yes. Happy-go-lucky, and then there is Marie Perahia who put all the Weltschmerz and all the beauty and all the hidden secrets of our existence into this innocent minuetto.
Well, innocent, but it has... so innocent.
And the coda, and the very coda,
which is... doesn't want to leave that.
Yeah, almost like a funeral march,
yes,
almost.
That's right. Yes. What's interesting in the great composers, it's never quite one mood that you can pinpoint. It's always a combination of moods, and there's a little bit gaiety, there's a little bit sadness, there's a little bit profundity, there's a little bit simplicity, all in one.
Yeah, this, you still have the wet eyes and the start of a smiling.
Yeah.
Marie, yes. Jackie, our producer, director, told me in secret that you are willing to do some four hands together.
With pleasure.
Thanks. Toda rabba. וזו גם ההזדמנות עבורי להודות לאורח היקר שלנו על שבא אלינו ועל המגינה הנפלאה שלו.